Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. I'm in my house in Orange County, New York, not Orange County, California. Sometimes people kind of forget or don't know what side of the country I'm on. It's Orange County, New York, in the northeast of the country. So I have gotten a bunch of requests via email, Facebook Messenger, about can I do a short video on how I got my rating, how did I get my IFR rating, instrument rating, if you will. And I'm kind of going to explain to you how I did it. It might work for some people, other people might be easier to do different things. So I'm going to tell you how I did it. And just so you guys know, I am not a good test taker. More of a hands-on type of person. I am not a good test taker. I got to do things differently. I mean, my sister can, study for an hour and get an A. I got to study for 5 days, maybe get a B plus or B minus. So that's how my brain operates. And there's a lot of people out there that are afraid of written exams, and I am one of them. I dread written exams. Matter of fact, it took me quite a while to do my private written exam after my student kind of like expired and I got signed off again, because I was afraid to take that private written test. I just dreaded it. So what I did was on the IFR exam is that I decided to take basically all of January of 2021, which was this year, and study every single day the whole month of January. So I took January and just studied. And that's why, if you guys noticed, this year I didn't put that many videos out there because I was studying for the written. And of course you need the 40 hours plus for your check ride and all that fun stuff. So it took quite some time actually to get that all in. And I didn't do a lot of video in between because of obvious reasons. Let's go back to January of 2021. So I did the King's course, very awesome course. They explain everything to you. And, you know, probably some of you guys also, again, I'm a hands-on person. I like being in the classroom, you know, and listening to teachers and, you know, following along, taking notes. So it was harder for me to do the online stuff because you get distracted. You know, it's just phone rings. You get a text message. Work calls you. So I get all that. And, you know, so I did the King's course. So what I did was to kind of not get interrupted. At night before I went to bed, I took my laptop to bed. And for about an hour to 2 hours, I'll go through the King's course. I woke up an hour early every morning and went through the King's course. So I probably did about a good 3 hours a day. Maybe sometimes on my days off from work, did 5 hours that day to get through this written. I knew in my mind, I didn't even want to do my hands-on IFR, doing approaches, doing all that fun stuff. I want to get the written test off my back and out of my mind because that's what I am not really good at. So I took that whole January, like I said, days off, probably 5 hours, while I'm working, before I went to work, after I went to work. Didn't do it while I was working, but days I was working, I took like about 2 hours in the morning and about 2 hours at night before I went to bed. And it helped me do it before I went to bed because, my mind kind of thinks as I'm sleeping. And so, but that's what I did the whole month, again, of January. Now, what I also did, American Flyers is a flight school. They're nationwide. They're based out of Morristown, which is about an hour and 15 minutes from my house in New Jersey. They happen to have a ground school course at the end of the month, the last 3 days of January. It was a Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So I was like, you know what? I did the King's, I passed all the stuff. If you pass all the King stuff, you can print out your notification to give to the person, I guess, I don't know what you call them, the person behind the desk at the written exam test site, the FAA, whatever you want to call them. Here you go, you can take the test. But I decided to do, you know what, to just the icing on the cake, just in case I had some questions. Again, I like to sit in a classroom, let me take this 3-day IFR course. It's jammed into 3 days. So Me, I could not jam in at the 3 days, take the test, and probably not pass because it's too much in 1 day and within 3 days. So it was about 8.5, 10 hours-ish. Friday, Saturday, Sunday was about 8 hours of just IFR ground school training. And the good thing about American Flyers is they didn't just give you, help you how to kind of get through the test. They showed you on the screens and the TVs how to do things, how to calculate things, what to look for, and also taught you what to look for in the real world, you know, when you're in IFR, weather, you know, all that fun stuff, you know, how to stay current, you know, how to stay proficient, you know, when to file an alternate, you know, all that stuff. And so it was really, really good. And I like, wow, this is like refresher course that I went through. When I went to the Kings, and this was like a nice refresher that, oh, I remember that. And then that Sunday, so it was Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And that Sunday, I was able to take the written exam. Which I came right out of the classroom. I think my appointment was 2:30. Came right out of the classroom at 2 o'clock. Went like next door from American Flyers, and it's in their area. And I took the written exam right there and there. I'm like, let me just get it over with. Some guys are like, ah, maybe you should wait for a week. Maybe you should take it, you know, 2 weeks. You know, go and, you know, make your brain unwind. I didn't want my brain to unwind because I'm not a good test taker. And since everything was so fresh after that 3 day and that Sunday, I'm like, let me just get it over with. And it took me quite a few hours, but I got through it and I passed, which was like, you know, I kind of went out to the guy at the desk. I said, how'd I do? He gave me that look and I'm like, oh, I guess I failed. But he printed it out and put it upside down on the desk. I'm like, I guess I failed because there was people around me. I guess he didn't want me to see what test score I got. But I looked at it and I passed. I was really, really happy. And I was like, wow, that is off my shoulders. Now, let's focus on all the fun stuff. Safety pilot, you can get 25 hours, I believe, of safety pilot time. And then the other 15, the last 15 hours, you need to have, obviously, a double-I instructor to do all that fun stuff, sign you off. You do cross countries, you do all the approaches. And I was like, but the test was over. The written exam was over. Let me tell you, it takes a lot off your shoulders. And it was worth just hiding myself in the house, not going out, not hanging out with friends, not flying, to just study after work, before work, and my days off to get this written out of the way because I'm horrible at written exams. And that's what I suggest people that are out there who are not good with written exams, especially online courses, because again, you can get sidetracked. Turn the phone off. You get sidetracked, you pause it, it's just turn the phone off and just study. Is it an easy exam? It's not easy exam. Some people say it was easy than my private. Some people say my private is easier than my instrument. Me personally, you know, my opinion is it was hard for this IFR written exam because there's a lot of things you have to know, folks. You just can't, I'm going to go up and do approaches. You got to know a lot of different things, and with weather, how to do approaches, what to look for, how to brief an approach plate, you know, how to look up alternate minimums. Every airport could be different, and you got to know all this stuff, and, you know, it's very important to know all that, and that's why when you get this rating, it does make you a better pilot. The training is great, and if you saw some of my videos, I did post a couple videos with Mike, my instructor, and, you know, when I was in the cloud to Block Island, going down to minimums to get into Block Island, you feel like the plane is turning. You really do. And that's what IFR is all about. Instrument flight rules. You have to just trust your instruments at all times. Even if you think the plane is turning, you must follow your instruments and you have to trust them. You really have to trust them. I know Your brain has no reference, so you can't reference anything to make sure you're straight and level or turning or dive or, you know, or descending. You know, you just don't know. And when you're in the cloud and you're going down to do an approach and you're following the needles as best as you possibly can, even with some wind that I was encountering, you know, I felt the plane was turning. And even Mike said, if you feel like the plane's turning, just follow your instruments, because he probably thought in his mind was plane was turning, but it's not. It's just not. And that's what a lot of the training is, to be focused on your instruments. A lot of the accidents I've had happen, people were not focused and they were not trusting their instruments, and that's what accidents unfortunately happens. Once you go into a spiral, it's very difficult to get out of. Now, if you're going into a spiral, you're not IFR, and you're a VFR pilot, and you're flying, get stuck in the clouds by accident, and it does happen. You know, it does happen. We've all been there. We need to avoid it, but it does happen. And if you feel like you're disoriented, and you're turning, and you're scared, let off the yoke. If you trimmed the way the plane's supposed to be trimmed, you let it off. And it should level itself out slowly and come out of the dive or turn or anything like that. So, you know, I was taught that as well. You know, when you're always in IFR flight, you're straight and level. Always trim the plane just perfect, because if you do get disoriented for whatever reason, you just let everything go and the plane should level itself out the way you trimmed it. If you have autopilot, of course, that's a lot easier. I don't have autopilot. My whole training was just hand flying the whole entire time. And when you're hand flying, especially in the check ride, it's a lot going on. It's you're constantly multitasking. And again, that's what IFR is, you're multitasking. The most busiest time is departure. Once you're up in the airway, and once you're just listening to ATC and following your flight plan, there's nothing going on. Then of course, going into an approach, more things happen pretty quickly and you're multitasking. If you have autopilot, that's helping you do an approach, that's a lot less off your shoulders. And if you get disoriented, you're in the clouds, you know, you don't know what's going on, you need a break, you just hit the autopilot is on. Or you hit the level button. If you guys have a level button in your autopilot, I'm waiting for Dynon to approve theirs for the Moonie, praying end of this year, early next year, you hit the level button, your plane will level out for you. But that's IFR flying. And It's scary. And there's another video of me flying, out of Orange County with Mike. We got into IMC probably a couple hundred feet, 300, 400 feet above the ground. I even told him, just watch me. It's my first time. And it is scary because you are training with your hood. Okay. You can't see the outside, or you're training with your goggles and you train, but you know, in the back of your mind that it's VFR outside, you know, it's VFR. It's just, it's fine. I'm gonna be fine. You know, if something happens, I'm gonna take my hood off. I'm gonna take my glasses off. Oh, I'm fine. But when you are an actual IMC, there's no turning back. There's no turning back. You just can't turn around and get out. It's just not gonna happen. So my first time was nervous, and it's just, if you're not nervous, something's wrong with you, because it is scary. And but it is amazing. It's amazing training, and it makes you a better pilot. But yes, the written is not easy. You got to study for it. You got to have to, mandatory to study for this exam. There is other stuff out there that just gives you the answers of the test, and you constantly go over it. I suggest don't do that. And the reason why I say that, because you need to learn IFR flying. It's great. You get through the tests. You can do your hands-on training with an instructor. But it's also really good to know how weather develops, how to stay current, all these things you have to know through the King's course or any course you want, as long as it's going over the course, what to look for, how to look for an approach plate, how to look for an alternate, how to look when to file an alternate. When you take an exam, you just know the answers. It doesn't really help you when it comes to actual flying, because the instructor who's going to teach you, when you pass the exam, knows that you pass the exam. I don't need to go over every little thing because you already passed the exam. So he's not going to tell you every little thing that you're supposed to have learned, you know, when you took your written exam. And then when you go for your check ride, it's a whole different ballgame. You got to know the answers. You know what he asked you in your oral. You got to know what's going on with your plane. You got to know how to do an approach. You got to know how to rebrief your approach plate. So we'll get to that in a minute on the check ride, but that's what I did on my written. Get it out of the way. Get it out of the way. Now, if you fail, no big deal. You just go and do a couple things, get signed off again with an instructor to go over what you maybe messed up on or whatever. So it's not a big deal. And, you know, it happens. It does happen. And, you know, I haven't been there yet, but I have been there with other things besides aviation, where I got a lower score and, you know, and things happen. But it happens to all of us. We're all not perfect. We all can't take tests like a lot of other people can take tests and no problem getting an A. I'm not like that. So let's move on. Let's move on to the training. Okay, I did a lot of safety pilot time. And my instructor, Mike Ryan, great instructor, flies a lot of different airplanes, knows what he's talking about, really, really cool guy. And really wants to help people learn, and that's awesome. I wasn't just another student and just get on with it and just pay me, let's go, hurry up. No, he takes his time, you know, wants to teach you things, and it's very, very cool that he did all that. And, you know, thanks again, Mike, for all the training. It was great training. But you're also allowed to have safety pilot time. So you have a guy next to you who's a pilot, and you have your hood on, and you can do approaches, you can fly around, you can do across country, get your time built up. You have to be under the hood at all times. And the safety pilot basically looking for traffic, and so on and so forth, which is nice. If you have a safety pilot who's IFR certified and is checked out in your plane, you can file and learn how to file. I know I use 4Flight. 4Flight makes it very, very easy to file. It makes it very easy to look at alternate minimums, makes you the weather, you know, the TPP. You know, it's just so much stuff in 4Flight that helps you when you're flying. So it's nice. So safety pilot time. And then the other 15 hours, you need, you know, the double I, if it makes sense. But I did more than that. I did more than 15 hours with him. We did a lot of flying. I wanted to make sure I got everything down pat for my check ride, because a check ride is intensive. It's, you know, you just need to know what you're doing. You know, this is it. This is your check ride. You know, they're gonna sign you off that you're good for for instrument rating. And instrument rating is, again, one of the hardest things you can get in aviation. Let's just face it. I don't like to sugarcoat anything with you guys here, so it is difficult. So we did all that fun stuff, did all my approaches, did all my, you know, different things I had to fly and do this and do that, did my 250 miles, I believe, cross country. I think went to Cape May down in Jersey and did all kinds of things. You had to do a VOR, RNAV, ILS approaches, you know, all that stuff. Go over the approach plate. And my biggest problem was my needles. And, you know, I don't know if, I think there's a video out there where Mike's like, Christopher, your needles. When he says Christopher, I'm in trouble. Because usually my name's, I know everybody calls me Chris. But when he says Christopher, I knew my needles were off. But as long as you're not a full deflection, you know, because we're not a full deflection, you could be 20 miles off course. You don't know where you are. But if you're off a dot or two, you kind of know where you're at, a mile or two or whatever. So you just get back on course and no autopilot. So when it's windy, and every time we went up, it was always windy. So I was always, you know, I was always like flying sideways and all that fun stuff. It is what it is, but it's great training. It's awesome. So, but you do all that stuff with him, or her, of course, on double I. And I want to thank again, everybody for helping me get through this, because for me, it wasn't easy with the safety pilot time and of course, Mike and everything else, and a lot of support from the aviation family. And thank you. A lot of do it, just get it done and do it. Go, go, you can do it. Any questions? And I would call a lot of people with questions. I thought I was driving them nuts after a while, but nope, they enjoyed helping me answer questions and getting through this. The check ride is the check ride. Everybody knows a check ride. The guy, you know, he or she has to make sure that you're capable of handling your airplane and handling what needs to be handled under a lot of stress. And I get really nervous with people next to me that's looking at me on every little thing I'm doing. So, you know, it is what it is. But I was prepared for it. The oral, you know, make sure your logbooks for your airplane is all up to date, because they don't want to go into a plane that's not annualed right, ELT wasn't out of date, and blah, blah, blah. They go through everything, and they want to get into a safe plane, number one. So they go through your logbooks for the airplane, prop logbooks, engine logbooks, airframe logbooks, and so on and so forth. But my airplane's been very, very well maintained from Motor Aviation. I've been going there 4 years. This will be my fifth annual coming up next year. And before me, the last owner used Motor Aviation, I think, for 10, 15 years or maybe more. So it's been very, very maintained. And it notes that Motor Aviation puts in the logbook is like perfect. And he was very impressed with the logbooks, that's for sure. And then, of course, after that's done, the oral. He's going to ask you questions on approach plates. He's going to ask you questions, MDA, DA. Questions. What does this mean? What does that mean? What does this chart do? What does this mean on the airway? And those are the questions that's going to be on the king's course? You know, and those are the questions that might be in American Flyer's course, which they were. They went over that, actually. And you have to know that. And again, I'm going to go back to this. Just getting the answers for an exam is not going to help you get through the oral. It's just not. You need to really go through a course. Again, if you're really good at it, you'll learn along the way. God bless you. Not for me. I wanted to kind of do it so I pass and not get a, I don't want a second, third chance. So they ask you questions about that, how to stay current, you know, how to stay proficient, when to file an alternate airport, how to file. We did a flight plan. He told me what to do. I had to do a flight plan for him the next day. Weight and balance, know your airplane, know what things do in your airplane, you know what horsepower your airplane is, what kind of engines in your airplane. These are all things you have to know, how to check the oil, and so on and so forth. And you also need to do in a check ride, you know, when you're taxiing. Explain to him what you're doing. Explain to him or her, you know, if the engine fails on in ground effects, what are you going to do? If the engine fails 1,000 feet off the ground, where are you going to aim for? You know, wind corrections, put the ailerons in the wind as you're taxiing. You know, clean up the plane, you know, and go over your checklist. You know, the airplane real checklist, not your mind checklist that we all get used to in our own planes. We fly them all the time. You know, departure checklist, climbing out checklist, you know, level checklist, you know, landing checklist. And then when you land and you clean up the plane, go over, you know, the landing checklist and make sure everything is perfect and that they want you to be proficient. They want to make sure you know how to handle your airplane that you're flying. And it makes a lot of sense. But those are the oral questions he's going to give you. And it's going to be about a couple of hours. There's no question. It's going to be quite a few hours, you know, and it's nerve-wracking when you're going through stuff. But let me tell you, I knew, you know, once he said, you know, let's go flying, that, wow, that was intense and it's over. Now the hands-on stuff comes into play. You got to do your approaches, obviously ILS, VOR, RNAV, make sure you go over all that stuff, make sure you know all that stuff. Holds, of course, and you know, if your airspeed is going down, you know, what do you do? Obviously you're in a pitch up position, you know what you do, full power, level the wings, level the nose. If your airspeed's going way up, what you're doing, and we did all that stuff. We did everything. And you need to know all that stuff. And a good instructor will get you through it and make sure they hit everything that's gonna be on your check ride. And when you hit all that stuff and you go over and over and over and over it, and you know, whatever you're doing, you're gonna pass the check ride. You're gonna pass the check ride. And if you have an iPad, okay, a lot of these check ride, you know, they let you use your iPad. You know, you can't use it. You gotta use it for reference. You can't use it to obviously fly for like a GPS. Obviously, we all know that. But anything that's in your airplane, you're allowed to use. You're allowed to use your GPS. Obviously, you're allowed to use. You know, I have the dyno screens, as you guys know. Allowed to use all this stuff, and I had the backup. You know, even though I had to do the partial panel, I had the backup. And my backup, the DA-10, gives my airspeed, the bank, you know, descending, all this stuff. So it really didn't matter if I had the partial panels. I had the backup, which was a 4-hour battery, and the dyno screen is about 45 minutes to an hour battery. So, you know, it was nice doing this in my airplane. And if you don't have this stuff, it's fine. You can still do it with the needles. You can still do the VORs and everything else. It's not a big deal. You just learn a different way. And I've learned that way too with Mike, you know, but, you know, I had all the glass. So the check ride was nice to get to have that in front of me instead of doing all the dialing. So that's basically the check ride. So know your area, because he might, or she might say, we're going to go here and do this and go here and do that and go there and do this. And then you get there, you do everything, and you're not doing that. You're doing something totally different on a, you know, VOR in a different place. And you're like, oh, shoot, I never practiced that before. You know, VOR-A approach. You know, I never did that before. So just know it and practice it, and you will have no problem. But it did take me quite a while, and that's why a lot of videos didn't go out, and I'm just starting to do videos and do things now, and got other things going on, work and stuff like that. But I'm going to get back into flying hardcore again very soon. It's been a rough year, and I'm glad that this a month ago, I passed everything, and here we are. And we're going to do IFR flying. You know, I'm planning on going to Arizona in my plane, hopefully bring Mike, and I'm going to have nice, you know, nice videos with that. And I'm really trying to build the channel up. Facebook is doing great, 36,000 plus people. Thank you. So that was basically my check, my written exam, how I did the written exam, the three-day course at Morristown, American Flyers. They're all over the country. So look up American Flyers. They always have a three-day course, IFR courses, commercials, and private, too. They have private, obviously, three-day courses as well. Did that. Did a lot of refresher. It came back. And went, I remember that. And I was that made me probably get the extra points and everything else on the written exam. You're going to have to know holds. And they can be difficult to understand, but once you do it a couple times, it's not that bad. So American Flyers practiced with safety pilots who just got their IFR, actually, which is perfect. A couple of my friends just got their IFR, and you know, Daryl and Vlad, all these guys really gave me a lot of good pointers, flew with me, and awesome pointers. And I always been bothering them. Even on the check ride date in the morning, I had everything spread apart before he came in. I said, what do I do with this? What does this mean? What is that? And just bothering everybody because I was so panicked. But then Mike Ryan, of course, did all the double I stuff and signed me off, and we got it all done. And that's basically how I did it. And I know you guys can do it. Any questions you have, don't hesitate to email me at pilotfun101@gmail.com. I'll give you as much information as I possibly can. But the only thing I can really stress is get the written out of the way. Once that written is out of the way, you're just like everything is off your shoulders. It's a big test to take, and it's very stressful. Especially if you're like me, I am not a good test taker. And I'll admit it to the whole world. I'm just not a good test taker. It is what it is. I'm just not, you know, and that's been my whole life. But I have to study extra hard to pass a test. Where I have other friends who study for an hour or two and just know what the hell they're doing. I'm like, how'd you know that? I don't know. It just comes natural. Good for you. Not for me. So take the written. Study the King's course. There's a couple other courses out there. I'm just telling you what I used. I used King's. I'm sure there's other programs out there you guys can use. I don't need to name all of them. But again, I suggest that you really take a full online course and not just get the answers. And then I also suggest that you do try to find an American Flyers course, three-day course, like a refresher. And then that last day, take the written, get it out of the way. And if you fail it, God forbid, then you take it again. That's all. It's not a big deal. Again, any questions? PilotFun101@gmail.com. Thank you guys so much for your support. PilotFun101.com. I'm selling shirts like crazy. I'm going to try to have new shirts available, maybe just Mooney shirts, and try to do a couple of things different. Sold out of a couple extra larges, an extra large in a couple of them. I have more on order. I have more mediums on order. I think I did about... last week, I think I did about 31 shirts, so I'm all over the country, and that's really cool. I don't have a big following on YouTube, but I have a lot of watch hours on YouTube. Tons and tons of watch hours, which means I don't just have fake subscribers. They're all actually watching, which is really, really cool, and thank you so much. Facebook, thank you guys. There are over 36,000 followers on Facebook. I have Instagram and on TikTok. Again, I'm getting more involved in that as time goes on, but I do have a full-time job, about 60 hours a week, so it's kind of puts me back a little bit, and we're building a new building, so that's going to take some more time, but it's okay. But thank you so much for your support. PilotFun101.com, email me, PilotFun101@gmail.com. Check me out on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, and TikTok, and we'll be up in the air soon. I'm going to edit another video that me, Pat, and Mike... We're on the last video that I just put out there was us going from Orange County to Sky Manor, and now I'm going to finish editing the video from Sky Manor to Block Island, and that will be out after this one is out. Until next time, guys, fly safe, be safe, and I'll see you in the cockpit soon. Thanks a lot.